All right, guys, another drive video. Just gonna try and talk. I think I've had it about 2 weeks. I don't know. It might be exactly 2 weeks, I think. It always seems longer, but it's not. One of my favorite things about this car now is the cluster, the gauge cluster, and that middle TFT screen, if that's what they call it. It's super high resolution. Nice and simple, shows me the gears, miles per hour, which I always use. So I really love the cluster. It's one of my favorite things about the car. And let's see, I'm gonna do a lot of comparisons on this little ride too, only fair. And as far as the seats, they're not as good as GTI seats. That should be a given. GTI seats are probably the best in the business. But I haven't got sore in these for the last 2 weeks. I know a totally different platform, but the CX-5 seats, even compared to the Forester, those were harder than these. These aren't the softest, most plush seats, but they also don't cause discomfort. I think I've been able to find a comfortable clutch position. Haven't had any knee hip problems or anything like I was kind of anticipating. Hasn't really happened. I guess I'm probably, since I run more than I used to and stuff like that, I guess my hips are a little bit stronger than they used to be quite a few years ago when I had a manual trans. The shifting, it gets tiresome, guys. Anybody that says I'm crazy for wanting to see, for wishing I'd got the CVT, you come hang out in San Francisco Bay Area for a while. In normal day hours and the commute traffic, it's a lot to shift this thing constantly. One thing about the gearbox I don't like is it's short first gear. It takes you to about 20 miles an hour, maybe 25 if you floor it, but you don't really want to floor it in first gear. But it really takes you to 15 to 20 miles an hour, and you can just barely get going for 2 seconds and you got to shift. So for me, it seems like it's harder to get a jump from a stop and really take off quick with this stick shift box. I know it's supposed to be about a full second quicker than the CVT, but that's hard to believe considering how clunky the first to second is. After that, it's good. Second, you can wind up to 50, 55 miles per hour probably. And third, fourth, and fifth just kind of are really nice on the freeway. They float. I would say on power, the GTI was better and a lot easier to drive around town. I mean, that's a fair statement. Different transmissions, obviously. But I think that this WRX has more power from 60 to, say, 90 than my Stage 2 GTI did. I honestly think that. It just really continues the same power feel much longer in your speed than the GTI did. It would, you couldn't accelerate as hard from 80 in the GTI, where here, 75-80, you just put it in, it just floats you and just kind of carries you. It feels so light. That's the thing about this car. Even now, it feels so light. And I'm actually going to give you a little freeway test for the road noise. I know I said the road noise was nothing. It was perfect. It has some road noise, you know. I'm starting to get used to it and starting to normalize to the different things about this car. It's hard to say if it has a lot. I mean, that's totally opinion. I mean, a lot to someone, maybe not much to another. The tires are new, so it's only going to get worse and louder as the tires wear down. That's one thing. Like, this is the quietest it's going to be because the tires are fresh, right? And I can hear the tires right now. Good thing this thing has a killer stereo too. I could easily drown out the tire noise with the stereo. As I mentioned somewhere, I don't know if it was in a forum or I think it was in a forum somewhere, that I can go down the freeway with the windows and sunroof open, and the stereo can almost drown out all the wind noise at 75 miles an hour. That's how good the stereo is. I'm going to get on the freeway over here. I don't know if you guys can read the screen up there. You probably can. It's not too bright outside. My average right now is 22. Now, at first I was kind of bummed, but then when I considered that 75% of my driving is city, I said that's not too bad for driving slow in traffic all the time, and also tickling the boost a little. I don't go full boost. I did crack both windows and the sunroof, by the way, give you some feeling of the sound and noise. So when I thought about that it's mostly city, and I get about halfway into boost, 6, 7, 8 all the time, 22 isn't bad at all for a car with this kind of sports feel to it. A lot of people are also trying to do comparisons to say this car to the Golf R, which is a really stupid comparison. You obviously compare this to the STI, not the WRX, the Golf R, what I'm saying. So if you want to say, why didn't I get a Golf R, you should be talking about the STI. It seems really noisy in here. I do have a mic right by my mouth, but I can hardly hear myself talk. So I'm going to roll up just the side windows and leave the sunroof open for now so I can get back focused on what I was saying. I think the STI is not as good a value as the WRX right now because of the new engine. And since the STI comes with the old engine, which gets terrible gas mileage, that's one reason why currently the Golf R is the king on that. I'm going to close this now, just because it seems really loud, and that just gave you a feel for how loud it can get in here. Like I said, if I could crank my music and it wouldn't be quite as annoying as it was. So, supposedly there's a new STI coming out in 16 or 17, a new engine specifically, and that's going to change everything in the Golf R versus STI wars. But for now, the Golf R is coming ahead in most of the reviews versus the STI, not the WRX. There's like a $10,000 difference there, so that shouldn't be compared. The fair comparison for this thing would be the GTI, of course, versus this. Both around 30, nicely loaded, something like that. This was actually 34 loaded, but as you know, I didn't pay quite that much. I'm in fifth gear. Sixth gear at, let me get an even mile per hour. Sixth gear, 65 miles per hour, 2,400 RPMs. So you can purr it if you want. Let me throw, even in fifth gear at 3,000, it has some nice pickup, 75, 80. It can go nice. I could have thrown it in fourth also. I'll throw it in fourth right now. It's only at $4,000, 72 miles an hour. You see, maybe you didn't see that cop on the other side going down, chasing someone else. I gotta be careful up here, I forgot. This is 92. I'm sure most of you around here know that. And there is cop traps up here. I'm still in fourth gear, 70 miles per hour, 4,000 RPMs. I'm not really supposed to go over four for break-in, but I'm not too strict on that. I mostly stay under four. But also, I really think this car could use a tune, honestly. It could. It actually feels not fast enough for me. Of course, anybody could say that about any car ever. Of course, you want more power. But I think just a little more power would be real nice on this thing. It just doesn't seem super crazy fast. It's just like a nice speedy sedan, but I wouldn't call it super sporty. And of course, I haven't fully floored it yet. That may not be too fair to say. I gotta get off somewhere here and figure out how to get home. I'm not gonna go on any hill rides or anything yet. It's a little bit early for that. because I would have to drive it pretty hard. I only have 550 miles on it right now. Find a place to turn around on here somewhere. I forgot, one of my favorite things about the car also, to get back to the beginning of the video, is how flat it stays in the corners. I've never had a car that stays this flat. I've kind of been testing it more and more when I go around a curve, and I just keep waiting for it to lean, and it just doesn't. It stays flat. It's like equal to like a modded out Toyotas and Hondas I had back in the 90s with all aftermarket stuff. It's easily equal to that, but this is a stock ride, so that's what makes it so much nicer. As far as fuel distance, when I fill up at this mile per gallon average computer, whatever, it says 340 miles for a tank. And I do put Supreme in this. Here in California right now, it costs me like $39 exactly. I'm always just short of $40 on the, gotta turn on the radar detector now, going this direction. So your tank might get you about 340 miles. Going 40, 45, a lot of cars coming. I can't really do much. There's a lot of traffic, unfortunately. Oh, I took it to 6 there. That's probably the first time since I've owned it that I took it to 6. Just wanted to see what it could do. I'm actually surprised it didn't really feel like it dropped off too much. I was pleasantly surprised with that. And the turbo whine got a little more. But of course, I don't want to be taking it up that high too often on this fresh engine. I want to be careful with it. That brings me to the tuning aspect too. Unlike the VW, which technically, supposedly, like APR and companies could hide the, sometimes I forget to shift, could hide the fact that you flashed if you went back to stock. Most of the Subaru guys here say that you cannot hide that, and even if you unmarry a Cobb, for example, as soon as a dealer checks out your computer, he can tell that the flash count's been changed and your ECU's been flashed. So it seems real cut and dry, according to most of those enthusiasts that know more about Subaru than me at this point. It's a major risk because of the history of Subaru engines. We all know what that is the last 5-10 years. And the unknown of this brand new engine, sure, it seems great, but you know, let's see how it's doing in 2 to 3 years is the real thing to do. So there's a big risk involved. If I flash it, which I do want to do, if anything happens, I mean, I just ate a, what, $3,000-$5,000 engine cost. And I know there's probably a 2% chance, if anything, that that would ever happen. But it's a concern, you know, especially it's a lease. I could get royally screwed on that. So I don't know if how many people with the WRXs have tuned already. I'm sure most of them, really, that's what you do with this car. And maybe they just take that risk and don't care. Maybe there's some misinformation about dealers easily detecting if you flashed your ECU or not, stuff like that. This video is probably getting super long, and I don't even know if you're still watching at this point. I'm starting to ramble. It's about time to cut it off. I can't drive too fast. There is a cop up ahead. Kind of bummed that when the detector starts slow, that's the only time it's a legitimate detection. When it's fast, it's a false alarm. There's a cop with his radar detector on up here somewhere. Oh, I saw him already turning the corner up there. So anyway, I'm not gonna be able to catch up with him anyway. There's a little freeway ramp. Won't really be able to show you the handling or how flat it stays. Oh my God, that's flat. I really can't wait to take it up in the hills, guys, but I have to wait for 1,000 miles on that before I really push it to its limits. Incidentally, in this video, I actually slid my camera more toward my head to try and give you a better view of the cluster. I'm gonna find out if it worked once I post it. if it just looks crappier and you can see even less, then I'm going to slide the camera back to the middle where it should be to get a better view. But I was just hoping maybe you can see this whole cluster a little bit more. But if not, then it was kind of pointless.